and welcome to GCL Tutorials. Thanks for your subscriptions, thanks for your likes, and it's a great time meeting you here again on this channel. I believe you enjoyed the last lesson we had on the various ethnic groups and where they came from. That's powerful. I'm sure you also made a lot of notes out of that lesson. Good. Today, I would like us to move from the settlement of our ethnic groups where they are presently found. We are now coming to talk about how they had their encounter with our colonial masters. And we had a lot of Europeans coming to this land, and they named the land the Gold Coast. We are going to look at the fact behind this, and we'll also look at other Europeans that came and left and what activities they perform or be engaged in on this particular land. Good. So we'll go straight to what I have on the board. On this card, I have the popular and the various European countries that came to this particular land. The Portuguese from Portugal, the British from Great Britain, the Dutch from Holland, or you can say the Netherlands. We have the Danes from Denmark, we have the Swedes from Sweden, and we have the Prussians from Russia. Good. Sounds unfamiliar. You get there. You don't know where they are today. These are countries or people who still exist today. When they came to this land, they performed a lot of activities. But we'll start with their years of arrival, when they arrived in this land that was later named the Gold Coast before it became Ghana. Okay. So we'll begin with the Portuguese. They were the first Europeans to have arrived on this land. The first Europeans, the Portuguese came first. Around 1415, we had already reached that part of Morocco. No, Africa is separated by the Mediterranean Sea from Europe. So the sea between Africa and Europe is the Mediterranean Sea. You can get an atlas, you can get a globe and locate where it is. So in our northern part, we have the European countries at our top. Good. Now, they decided to embark on a lot of journeys. They were led by these great sailors or captains of their various ships, and they traveled far distances to explore other lands to see whether they can discover other lands and look for more resources, because those countries became industrialized. That means they started creating a lot of industries where they needed a lot of raw materials to produce goods and services. Okay, so beginning with the Portuguese, they were led by one of the popular or greatest captains in their time, known as Prince Henry. So Prince Henry led the Portuguese, and he discovered that land called Equatorial Guinea today, that part of West Africa. So when they settled there, others also saw the riches of the land. The land was rich in gold and other resources. So they decided to explore other lands and see if they can discover more. So a section or a group of them were led by Don Diego da Zambuja. So Prince Henry, actually, we can say, led them to West Africa, and Don Diego da Zambuja led them to discover the land where we call Gold Coast before it became Ghana. Okay, I hope you are following the issue. So we have Prince Henry and then Don Diego da Zambuja bringing them to the Gold Coast. So when we read our history, it looks like his name has become more popular than Prince Henry. But we can't also leave Prince Henry's name out of our history, because he led that general expedition and we discovered the land of West Africa. When Don Diego da Zambuja came, they entered a town which was traditionally known as Adina. Adina. Well, so what happened there? As at the time he discovered that land, the chief of the land was Nana Kwame Nkrumah. Nana Kwame Nkrumah. So the blacks or the people of Kogos as at that time or Adina saw these whites, and well, you know, when you meet strangers, how you are going to behave towards them. It wasn't a comfortable one for the whites at all. But gradually, they started interacting with the people in their own way, because the people did not understand the language they spoke at that time. So what happened was that they began to trade with our people, began to trade with our people. And they discovered more of the resources. They found a lot of gold on the land, and the gold was along the coast, because the place was a coastal area. When they discovered the gold, they decided to name the place the mines. The mines, and since they were Portuguese, they decided to call it Damina. Damina, which means the mines, where they discovered a lot of gold. So the mines. After naming the place the mine, and they obtained a lot of gold, they can't carry all of them to their country, and they needed storehouses. Storehouses. So they built castles and then forts. And the castles were primarily meant for the storing of these goods or resources that they discovered on that particular land. So they built the first castle built, and that was the Elmina castle. So Damina later became Elmina, and we had the Elmina castle. They named it after one of their leaders, Saint George. And in their language, Saint George is spelled so we have a Saint George castle, which was the first castle built on this land. And that was in 1482, the Elmina castle, or the St. George castle, 1482, the first castle that was established or built in the Gold Coast. So we have discovered few facts about the Portuguese and their initial activities when they came to this land, or when they discovered this land. Let's move to the next European, the British. They came after the Portuguese. The British came after the Portuguese in 1553. So the British were led by Captain Wyndham. And they also discovered this land and started their trading activities. So the trading actually cut across, and we can say that that was the main activity, or the first activity that the Europeans engaged in when they met the blacks or the people of Gold Coast or West Africa here. Let's get to the Dutch, the people of Holland or the Netherlands. the Dutch came in 1595, not quite too long, just some few years after the British arrived here. They came here. The Danes from Denmark, also arrived on this land in the year 1642. And you remember the popular Osu Castle, which is originally known as a Christian Wall Castle, was built by the Danes, a Christian Wall Castle. And I'm sure some of you have been there, maybe talking about excursions and touring places. The Danes built the Christian Wall Castle. Good. The Swedes from Sweden arrived here in the year 1647. They came to this place. All these Europeans left, and the British stayed. So the British then had the intention of colonizing the Gold Coast, but they needed more of the raw materials, and they also engage in other activities. We'll be moving on to look at the activities that they engage in. Good. So take note that the arrival occurred between the 15th and 17th century. Check the year 1471 is in the 15th century. And the Prussians. The Prussians today, you can find them in parts of Germany and other neighboring countries in Europe. So they are there, people of Russia. Okay. Only the British were left to colonize the Gold Coast. After all these people left, the Christian Wall Castle, for instance, was sold by the Danes, sold into the British, and they had to take over that castle. The British also took over the Elmina Castle, the St. George Castle, and used them as their storehouses, and they also established their castle schools. We'll be talking about that soon. So these were times or the years of arrival of the various European countries that came to this land. And I believe we got it to this point. That's great. So now, we will then look at the various activities that the Europeans engaged in, the various activities of the Europeans. Okay, we'll start with trade. Primary activity, a primary activity. So trade, they began to trade with our people. So they introduced the barter trade because our people couldn't understand their language and they didn't know the usage of currency or how to use currency, that is money. We're not using money, we're not familiar with that system where you have to take money and buy something from another person. So all they will do is that what our people have, they will bring what they also have and then exchange it with what the people have. So they engage in the barter trade. So the first form of trade was a barter trade, which implies that exchange of goods for goods. Exchange of goods for goods. So if the wise man is bringing alcoholic beverages, or is bringing mirror or sugar or any other products that they have, the black man will give gold in exchange. Then from there, they expanded the trade across the Saharan Desert, and that became the Saharan trade, Trans-Saharan trade. The trans, we just say the transfer of goods across the Saharan Desert. The transfer of goods across the Saharan Desert. Good. After obtaining all these resources, or all these goods, the gold, and they had the salt and all these things, they took them to their country. Now they needed manpower. People have to help them process all these goods, and they needed more. So they, as they discovered fertile land elsewhere in part of America, they needed strong and able men, and they can't do that job. So they came for our men and used them to work on those lands, the able men for that matter. And some of them were sold to other masters that they call slave masters. And these people use the humans or the manpower that we had and could have stayed here to develop our land. We took them away to go and work on the sugarcane plantations in America and part of the Caribbean, and they were later taken back to Europe to go and work in these factories or industries. So that created, it became so profitable that people were now coming down to Africa here to buy slaves, So it turned to the slave trade. I'm sure you heard about stories concerning the slave trade, and people expressed a lot of displeasure today concerning the slave trade. Looking at how these people were taken away, it was so sad. The able men, some of them had to leave their families behind, and they have lost their identity. And some had to die because of the conditions that they had to go through. So the slave trade continued for so many years. We were buying the slaves in West Africa. We had this popular slave called Babatu, slave master called Babatu, and he was buying a slave. He came to the northern part of Ghana in those days and bought a lot of slaves. The main slave centers that we had were Asimanso, and Salaga slave market. These two key places, they bought the slaves from the market, and when their ship is about to arrive, they bring them to the coastal area. There is this town in the central region, Asimanso, where they go there and have their last bath. So they go, the slaves will go there and have their last bath, and they will take them through the bushes. The path is there leading to the coast. They wait for the ship, and they will have to keep them in part of the castle where they had no light, they were under severe hot temperature and felt so uncomfortable. They packed all of them into their ship and took them to the Americas and other European countries. When I say Americas, I'm referring to North America and South America. Those places, they had a lot of blacks there who worked on the plantation farm, or the sugarcane plantation, producing a lot of crops for the whites.
Okay.
Sounds so sad, right? Doesn't feel good when you are talking about these past events. Slave trade was sad indeed.
Okay,
so now let's move on. This slave trade continued for so many years, and then until some of the Europeans realized that the treatment that were given to these blacks was not the best. Treatment was not the best, and it is dehumanizing. It is not fair to the blacks as they claim. And others still feel that after they have had enough to feed their industries, and these people who were the able men had come to help them to process their goods, and they've been able to get all the processed and finished goods, and were bringing them back to Africa to sell to our people and other places, because Portugal and those countries were also creating a lot of industries, establishing a lot of factories. So they had all their products. So who is going to buy from it? So the next place to turn their attention to was Africa. So they had to come back to Africa and give us those goods or products that they have manufactured or processed. Okay. So at a point in Great Britain, there were these lawyers who fought against the slave trade because they saw it as an activity that was against the rights of, or the fundamental human rights of these people, the blacks, of course. So it was gradually leading to the abolishment of the slave trade. I'll give you the names of these popular people. We had a man called Granville Sharp. We had Thomas Clarkson. We have William Wilberforce. Then later, the preacher man, John Wesley, also joined to campaign. He preached against the slave trade. So gradually, people were getting a whole lot of pressure, receiving pressure from some of these people, and who stood on their ground to speak for the blacks. Then, one time, a slave known as James Somerset, escaped from his master, and he had to be taken to the court for doing or taking such an action. So what happened? He had to be defended in court. And in that court, Thomas Clarkson was able to defend him in court. The British Chief Justice at that time was called Lord Mansfield. So at the end, the case was won in favor of the slave, and he successfully. So the British had to issue an act or a legal decision had to be taken to abolish the slave trade. And that was around the 19th century. So in 1807, around that time, the slave trade was abolished in Great Britain. And Great Britain was a very big country, and they had been very, very successful in the slave trade. And a lot of other European countries had to go there and even buy slaves from the slave masters. And if this country had now abolished the slave trade, then all those countries had no choice than to stop and then release all the slaves that they had. So some of them were had to be freed to other parts of the America where they settled, or where they took them first from Africa, because they couldn't bear the cost to bring them back to their homeland. So they were taken there, and they were called the Maroons. You find a lot of them in Jamaica today. Their descendants are there. So people still see them as Africans. And of course, yes, their ancestors or their forefathers were taken from this land. So they always want to come back and see where they were taken from. So Gold Coast produced a lot of slaves. Good. Now we have the names of these people who fought hard. I think we've talked enough about the trade that actually took place on this land called the Gold Coast. We'll look at education. Now concerning education, they established their castle schools because they didn't have a lot of school buildings as at that time. And the castles that were primarily meant for the trade centers or as storehouses to store the goods that were exploited by the whites later were transformed into castles. So the Almina Castle, the Cape Coast Castle, the British themselves established that, and they enrolled their children, because some of them had given birth to children who were of half black and half white. Or they came here to, some got married to our people. You go to the central region, you have a lot of them bearing the European surnames. Good. So through that education, they were able to teach the people and also let them know their culture. So as part of that, most of the things that they introduced in their curriculum or their syllabus that they were teaching them were centered around the white man's culture, and the people had lessons on three areas. So we call them the three R's: establishment of castle schools and secondary schools to teach the three R's. So basically, you have to be taught the three R's. What were these three R's? So we had reading, writing, narrative. These were basic subjects. Later they added religious instruction, which became a fourth one. So in the castle, after they had these lessons, they were also taught the things in the Bible, the scriptures, for them to know the fear of God, and also know about creation, and also know how to comport themselves and behave morally. Okay, so the three are, you know, the reading, how to read, started with the letters, the alphabet. So people even began to read like the whites and speak like them. Because that is what they were trying to achieve in the past. So the writing, they were able to write, and then how to do simple math calculation. Good. So these were the three arts that they introduced in their castle schools. When the castle schools started, the whites had the chance to go because it was meant for the white children. It was later they enrolled children from rich homes. If you are not rich, you can't go. Go like us. So the chiefs who were rich, you know, they were the custodians of the gold. They were rich, so they started taking their children to their schools, and they were taught how to read and write, and they were happy. A child can come home and tell you about A, B, C, and then math, 1 plus 1, and then times 2. So they were so excited. So they got more people from those royal homes, and later people also decided to send their children to those schools. So these were the subjects and the all about education. And later they started establishing more schools. We had the first secondary school, the Fancy Pimp School, which was established in 1876. And the oldest, of course, is also established other schools. Now we have those who came to preach the gospel. So evangelistic work, the preaching of the gospel. So the missionary activities, such as establishment of churches and the spread of the gospel, also took place. One of the main purposes of this was to prevent the domination of Islam. But you know, as we learned in one of our lessons, Islam had already arrived in this part of the continent, so it was Africa, in the 11th century. So they were actually dominating and spreading their word, their gospel. So these whites also came and also decided to spread their gospel and influence the people. And the gospel they called the good news. Good news. So the establishment of the churches, the old missionaries that came. So we look at them one by one. We'll begin with the Roman Catholic. They are still in the system today. They have churches all over Roman Catholic. As Roman Catholic. So they came, they are fathers, those tomorrow people who brought the Roman Catholic to this place. So the first church, the oldest, their name hasn't changed. Then we have the SPG, Society for Propagation of the Gospel. They also came, and the man Joseph Dambo, came with that gospel. The leader, actually, Sir Thomas Thompson, you have heard about that name. And that this church had become the Anglican Church today. So they are the Anglicans. So Joseph Dowell came, and they were able to train the popular Filipino in the central region. So Filipino was sponsored, giving a scholarship to go and learn more about their religious teachings and practices. So he schooled there and had his education in this area and came down to continue with the work that Mr. Daniel had already started in the Gold Coast. Then we also have passing missionaries, they allow called a Presbyterian, the Presbyterian that you hear, a Presbyterian missionary. So that's the Presbyterian church that we have in Ghana today. Then we also have the West Indian missionaries. The West Indian missionaries. So the West Indian missionaries also founded by the West Indian came to the Gold Coast, and they are now a Methodist church. A Methodist church. So these missionaries brought the gospel or the good news, came to preach to the people, and they spread their messages across. Okay, so I mentioned that John Wesley also, as a preacher man, campaigned against the slave trade. We can also talk about the Bremen missionaries. So you hear of evangelical Presbyterian, or you hear of global people. Founder Lawrence Wolf, who's who attend that church, he will know the founder. So, I will call them the hippie church, the hippie church. Okay. So these churches were established, and most of them had schools. So we're talking about the Umakali schools, the SHS schools, a lot of them. So they had the schools and then the church at the same time. So as they are teaching the people how to read and write and do simple math, they are also teaching them the religious, or giving them the religious instructions. That's good. I believe you have. Alright, so we have looked at the various missionaries that came to the Gold Coast and how they are called today. Is the same church and the same practices that we have. You may be a member of one of these churches, so you know their practices. Good. So we have been able to discuss the arrival of the Europeans and then their activities, the trading activities, the missionaries, what they came to do. And we have also looked at education, the castle schools, and what they taught, the primary purpose of their teachings. And we've also looked at so many facts concerning the establishment of the various churches. My viewers out there, it's been a great time, and we've been able to talk about a lot. We will have more lessons, and I'm going to bring you more on these organizations. The journey has just begun, and keep liking, keep subscribing, share to people, let others to come and watch this, and also take a lot of notes from this lesson. Next time, we'll be looking at how the organization itself started and what actually took place after our people went into agreement with the whites, and what actually happened, the events. And we'll see whether it helped us or not. So we'll talk about the positive and the negative effects of colonization. But for today, it's been a great time. And thanks for watching. Thanks for your time too as well. I believe you'll be expecting the next lesson. This is what time will allow us to discuss today. Thanks for watching once again. See you another time.